We've had a great day so far. For those of us here in Nigeria, it's about 5 p.m. And for people, we have a few people as well who are in the U.S., good morning to you all. And wherever you are, morning, noon, or night, good day. This evening, we'll be having a conversation together. And last week, about last week or 2 weeks ago, we started talking about solving our lives, the daily life challenges and problems we have through the lens of Christ. And that journey is on, and we'll be on that journey for a couple of weeks. And I hope that as we do this, you know, God will help us find answers to questions that burden our hearts and the action steps that we need to take as a result. Amen. This evening, we'll be talking about where is your dare? And that was the title that was sent out. And that's what we'll be having a chat about over the next 45 minutes thereabouts. And I would like to begin with a simple question. We had a chat as well this morning, in the mornings in the physical service. And for many of us who were in there, I would like to have an answer as well. So my first question will be, how many of us have considered, and that's if you are not currently working in that reality, how many of us today have considered relocating? Okay, you can just use the chat box and type yes, if that fits you. How many of us have considered relocating? So just put in yes in there. Pastor says yes. Okay. Radan says no, never. Okay. Interesting answers. Okay. I have a yes. I have a no. I have a never. Okay. Anyone else? I have a couple of us in the room tonight. How many of us have considered relocating? No. Wow. We have. Pastor says, I relocated from Milwaukee to Lagos. That relocation. Oh, God. On and off. Okay, so sometimes the thought comes, sometimes it doesn't. My, that's not the relocation we are talking about, though. Mrs. Bada says, not yet. Ah, okay, we have a lot of people in the house tonight who have never considered relocating. We have a lot of people who are loving their current location. today, I mean, in many conversations, relocation is always a burning topic, right? Many people are always talking about relocating. There's almost no time. I'm in the company of, you know, guys my age, classmates, friends, at work, where this topic doesn't always, you know, just pop in from time to time. Everyone is talking about relocating. And we have a slang for it now. We say we want to jaapaaa and leave the country. and that's the reality. And I mean, many people, of course, have different destinations in mind. So I'm sure if I ask us tonight, even though we have not considered relocating, if I say, oh, if you were to relocate today, what country would be top of mind for you? Any takers? If you were to relocate today, what country would be top of mind for you? What country would you love to relocate to? Okay. MI says Canada, obviously. Bernard says Canada as well. Okay. So where is Mrs. Feyi at the moment? Mrs. Feyi, listen, I believe that's the US. So
it's in Abeokuta.
I don't understand. You want to be looking from Abeokuta to Nigeria? So Mrs. Grace is saying Me, I'm not leaving this place. So even in my dreams, I want to stay in Nigeria. Okay, that's interesting. Technopop 4, I don't know what that is. Canada. Wow. Everybody in the room seems to be gravitating towards Canada. Mrs. Bada says Australia. CM says Abuja. CM, it's just for this. Gama says F when God is ready. Gama, okay, so Gama is in the US, so we'll leave you there. You have relocated. Okay, so Ms. Ayobule says US for sure. Okay, so Canada, US, Nigeria, those in that order. Service, welcome to Abuja anytime. All right, so interesting. And I mean, like I said, this is a conversation that pops up almost every other day. People are talking about relocating. And I was checking, just doing some little research around the topic of relocation. And I'll share a bit of what I found out quickly. In 2019, over 12,000 Nigerians relocated to Canada alone. And this is, of course, legally, right? People will go, will get their papers, will, you know, apply the normal way and get in the normal way. About 12,000 of them relocated to Canada in 2019. And that was about 4% of the total intake for that year in Canada. And we're only like number 4 behind India, China, and Philippines in that order. So India, China, Philippines, and then Nigeria in that order in terms of immigrants to Canada. Okay. And of course, that research says that that number has basically tripled over a 5-year period, with a lot more people relocating to Canada today. As of 2017 as well, there were about 348,000 Nigerian immigrants living in the US. 348,000 Nigerian immigrants living in the US, making Nigeria the top birthplace among African immigrants in the country. Okay, making Nigeria the top birthplace among African immigrants in the country. And in another interesting research, people were asked how many of them would like to move to another country sometime within the next 5 years. And Nigeria topped that list. 45% of Nigerians say that they plan to leave for another country within the next 5 years. 45% of Nigerians want to take that action. And that is one out of every two Nigerians basically saying, I want to leave this country within the next 5 years. And of course, for many people, that timeline is just connected to how soon they see themselves, you know, putting together the resource that they need to be able to take that journey into relocating. And you know, those are like the numbers. And I was also checking over, you know, since about 1950, how relocation has been for Nigerians. And this research tried to measure the net immigration per 1,000 Nigerians, the net immigration per 1,000 Nigerians since 1950 till date. And in that research, Nigeria had the highest net immigration per 1,000 of our citizens in 1978. And we had the least so far in 1983. And interestingly, 1983, of course, was when Muhammadu Buhari was president in Nigeria. 1978 had Obasanjo. And we're kind of like back to those times, even in democracy, right? And those are like the numbers, you know, funny enough. So 1978 had the highest, you know, what's the word now? Exodus, right? Out of Nigeria, you know, to whatever country. I'm guessing back then it might probably be the UK, because I believe at 1978, UK was still visa-free for many Nigerians. And by 1983, that number was at its lowest. And of course, there are many factors that have contributed to that, but that's not our topic for discussion today. But one out of every two Nigerians have said that they want to relocate within the next 5 years. And that makes this a burning topic that should be discussed. And just this last week, it just to add some fire to that conversation, we had a viral video from one of the popular pastors in Nigeria saying that, you know, encouraging their members to kind of like just get out of this country, whether it's by speedboat to Cameroon or it's by Okada to Ghana, whatever the person just says, get out and get a plan B. And so, of course, that of course added a lot of fire to the conversation of relocation and, you know, of course, encouraging a lot of people to want to take the action of just leaving this country and just, you know, finding somewhere else to kind of like spend their time and, you know, and move on with their lives. Now, why is this even so interesting? Why are people considering these options? And of course, it's in our faces, right? Especially when we hear of the, you know, interesting things that even Nigerians who are not in the country are doing. So today, in 2017, for example, research shows that Nigerians in the US, or people in the US, sent $6.2 billion in remittances to Nigeria in 2017. $6.2 billion was sent from people in the US to Nigeria in the year 2017. And that is not a small number. And of course, that was more than was sent to any other African country today. And those are like significant numbers in remittances. And at 2016 as well, 6 in 10 Black Nigerian immigrants in the US, about 59%, had a bachelor's degree or more in terms of education. 59% Nigerian immigrants in the US had a bachelor's degree or more. In fact, I was reading about this guy who had, I think, is it 5 masters? And it's about 8 masters and 4 PhDs in Nigerian in the US. And, you know, people are studying and, you know, and that's some of the interesting things happening, you know, over there in that country. And with Nigerians, with 59% Nigerians having bachelor's degree or more, that in itself is roughly double that of the overall American population. So Nigerians are reading, Nigerians are, you know, sending money back home, doing interesting and amazing stuff over there in the US. And when you see these numbers, when you see this research, people feel, you know, it's just time for me to go. And of course, people probably hear stories of their friends and of their relatives who have relocated, and, you know, they see life being better for them. They see them doing interesting things. And I was sharing, of course, in the morning service, how a cousin of mine, for example, was earning 20,000 naira per month here in Nigeria. 20,000 naira per month was her monthly salary, and that was what she earned while in the country. And this is, of course, someone who had, you know, who went to school, had higher education, and she works as a receptionist at an hotel and was earning 20k per month. And of course, that's probably, you know, that I'm not, you know, in the Nigeria of today, there's not even much you can do with that. But that was what she was earning. And, you know, she decided that, you know, I just need to get out of this country. And, you know, she did that thing and got into the US. And she's been there for about 4 years now. And, you know, the journey has been interesting for her. I've seen her, you know, do things that she was struggling to do, even here in Nigeria. Even her side hustles in Nigeria, she's still able to do them even in the US. She's able to afford to get the tools that she needs to do the things she wants to do. She's able to support even her parents better here in Nigeria. And, you know, sharing how, you know, within, she's been up about a year, she was able to support her mom to start a business, help her to get an apartment, you know, sending millions of naira home to basically help our family, you know, live better even in the country. And these were things that literally felt impossible for her when she was in the country. And you know, you hear these stories like this, and of course, it motivates, you know, the average person who is listening to their friends talk about how, you know, life is different for them, want to go and just leave. And people are finding all sorts of ways to leave the country just to get out. And today, you know, you hear of people walking through the Sahara Desert to get to locations where they feel they can access better lives. And of course, many people die just going through that journey. Or people get to Libya, I believe, and then they jump, you know, they try to get onto a boat that will take them across the Mediterranean Sea to go to Spain. And of course, many of them die in that journey as well. But it still is not deterring many people from taking that journey. People are still taking that journey to want to go, all in the quest for a better life. Today as well, of course, many people I do travel packages for people from time to time. And one of the things you see, even with a lot of travel companies, is when it comes to putting together travel vacations or vacations for people to go to countries like the US, the UK, Europe, it's always a major concern, because many people go and they just disappear from there. I remember Emma was sharing with us how her dad was, you know, went to Israel, you know, with a couple of people, and his roommates while on the trip, these are not young people, these are married men with children, his roommates while on the trip just vanished into thin air and did not return back into the country. And of course, now I'm in Israel, now I'm in the birthplace of Jesus, I can find a new life for myself. Wow! Okay, I didn't even know it was that ridiculous. So 34 people went, 21 of them disappeared. These are not young people, right? These are like people who were married, have kids, who went to Jerusalem, of course, on pilgrimage, and did not return back to the country. And these are things these are things that are happening today in the country. People go, as you know, for some things. We've heard people, of course, who travel, they seize their passport, and they literally live as slaves in another man's country, all in the quest for a better life. Of course, refugee claims as well is on the increase. And as of 2019, one of the research I was going through said Nigeria had by far the highest number of pending refugee protection claims in Canada. Nigeria had by far the highest number of pending refugee protection claims in Canada. And of course, people getting there, and you know, these are people who probably maybe go to the US, and then they go through the borders of from New York into Canada, and they just say, you know what, I'm gay. The people in my country want to kill me. I have, you know, Nigeria doesn't permit being gay, and people are trying to kill me, people are trying to harm me. So I'm here in Canada seeking asylum, right? And these are people who are married with children. Like someone said to this body, with children, sis. But then we get to Canada and then we say, oh, I am gay, people are trying to kill me, and then I get in. And of course, they share with their friends back home how I'm in Canada on asylum, I'm being paid X hundred of dollars every month. And what happens? You find all these straight guys beginning to go over to Canada to also see that they are gay. And we do all forms of things just to ensure that we can access better life. And the reality, of course, is right in our faces. Today, if you look at the situation of the country where we are in, you can, common sense, of course, reveals a lot of things to us. If you look at today at the level of insecurity in the country, then common sense shows why people just want to get out of this place. For example, myself, I had my own share of experience last year on my way to Ilorin, and you know, God was able to save myself and my sister-in-law and my brother-in-law from a kidnapping attempt. It was a bloody night somewhere between Ogbomosho and Ilorin, but we thank God that we are still alive today, and God was able to keep us from evil. But these are the realities that people face. People are being kidnapped every day. People are being asked for all forms of all sorts of money, 5 million, 10 million. Before I'm hearing, I was in a conversation the other day, and you know, I heard that even in Lagos today, there is an increasing kidnapping ring where people are kidnapped in, you know, on the island, and they are taking just, and this particular ring asks for it. They don't ask for big money. They're not asking for 20 million or 10 million. They're asking people for 1 million, 1.5 million. And because they know that these are like, you know, people who can easily just transfer this while in the bus with them. They are not taking them into one bush somewhere. They just kidnap you. You are in a bus. They are driving you around Lagos. They get you to transfer 1 million or 1.5 million. And then they push you out of the car and the transaction is done. And that is becoming an increasing reality here in Lagos. You know, someone wakes up in the morning, is just jogging on the Ikoyi Bridge, and then boom, you are thrown into a bus, and you got to transfer 1.5 million, 2 million, 1 million before you are let go of. And of course, these realities is what is pushing a lot of people to want to leave the country. And of course, people talk about, I just want to create a better life for my children, a better education for my children. I just want my children to be able to access better life. And of course, when you ask many people, this is like one of the top things people talk about. I want to create a better life for my children. And increasingly, that's becoming a topic of discussion. People want to ensure that their kids have access to better education, have access to better opportunities than they did. And that is leading people to make that discussion of how do I leave the country? And of course, healthcare is another major issue why many people, of course, are trying to leave the country. Healthcare today in Nigeria, Nigeria ranks 187 out of about 190-something countries in terms of healthcare. And that, of course, is a shocking reality. And even when you have the money, you are even at risk. Just 2 weeks ago, we heard of the sad case of a woman who, after paying about 4 million naira, still died due to negligence from the medical team that attended to her. And these are the realities people face today. And so even when you have the money, not to even talk about not having the money, people, you know, live in a state where they are unsure of what will happen to them next. And of course, that's leading people to say, you know what, when it comes to healthcare, I just want to leave this country. Let me go and access healthcare outside. And many times, just let me stay over. And I remember this story I heard of a friend share with me that in their office, and I won't mention, just because of 5 points, right? I won't mention the name of the hospital, the popular hospital in Ikeja, and how this woman, who was a colleague at work, I tried giving birth in this hospital 4 times. And those 4 times, she lost the baby. 4 solid times. And every single time, she lost the baby. And after the 3rd time, I think the hospital, after the 4th time, the hospital told her that if she gets pregnant again, they will take care of her bills to go try to attempt to give birth overseas. And after the 4th attempt that she lost the baby here in Nigeria, on the 5th try, imagine that, on the 5th try, she traveled to the US, and the mother and the baby are still fine till today. And of course, these are shocking realities. And when it comes to healthcare, people just want to get out. And those are, of course, the realities that we face as a country. Unemployment today is about 24%. And many of our youths have nowhere to get jobs, have no access to getting something to just even sustain them to live better. And of course, people are going into crime. People are doing all sorts of things. There's yahoo yahoo all over the place, all in the quest for me to live a better life. And when you look at all of this together, you know, common sense just tells many people that, you know what, maybe this country is not worth stressing about. And someone was telling me during the week how, you know, in their neighborhood, there's been a series of robbery, and, you know, just sleeping and waking up now is, you know, is just thanking God, like, at least we survived another night here in this Lagos. And it's been robbery upon robbery almost every other night. One house has been attacked, that house has been attacked. And every night when they just sleep and wake up, they're just grateful to God. And you know, when you're now living in fear in your own house, all these realities, of course, makes people just start, you know, looking for ways to get out. And you know, many people don't even talk about it, but of course, a lot of like we saw in that research, one out of every two Nigerians is trying to find their way out of the country. And of course, we live in a country where people don't even talk about these things. People show up at work today, and the next day they are in Canada. people just feel, you know, don't talk about these things because they can just jinx it for you. So just keep quiet, just be looking at everybody. And then once everything is done, passport done, ticket done, you know, when you are in Canada, your life in Canada, you send an email. You know, I remember, you know, there was a post making the rounds during the week how a student was asking his home teacher if he was coming to teach him to the next day. And the teacher replied, "I am no longer in Nigeria. I am not coming back." and those are the things that are happening, because nobody's talking about this. Everybody's just looking up. Okay, I'm planning. But that guy that's saying he's planning already has his visa, ready to board the next flight. And like I said, it's just common sense, right? For many people, it's common sense to get out of the country and look for greener pastures, And of course, over the scriptures, relocation is not a new thing. There's a lot of relocating that happened in the scripture. And a popular scripture that we use today to talk about relocation is in Genesis 12:1. And you know, I see a lot of people posting this all over the place today, changing the name from Abraham to, you know, to Moses, you know, to Wale, to Kule. It's time to go. So the Bible says in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, and I will read quickly to us. The Bible says that now in Aaron, the Lord had said to Abraham, and people change Abraham to represent their own name. And, you know, people begin to personalize the scripture. Go away from your country. Go away from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you abundantly and make your name great. And so people say, you know what? God is speaking to us. Go away from your country. And I think KJV says, leave your country. And so people say, you know what? God is saying to me, like he said to Abraham, it's time to leave the country. And of course, we see from right there that, of course, Abraham had to relocate upon the instruction of the Lord. Naomi as well is an interesting case of relocation that happened in Ruth chapter 1. Of course, in Ruth chapter 1, 1 to 7, and I will read the beginning verse of that. I will come back to talk about the rest of it. It says, in the days when the judges governed Israel, there was a famine in the land of Canaan, and a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live temporarily in the country of Moab with his wife and his two sons. The man's name was Elimelech, and his wife's name was Naomi. And his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. Okay? And these, of course, were Israelites who, upon famine, carried their bags and got out. And basically what's happening in Nigeria today, there seems to be famine all over the land. People are struggling even to eat. It's a real struggle for millions and millions of Nigerians. And research shows that for many Nigerians today, 65% of their income is spent on feeding. And so we live in a country where people are just literally trying to eat. And so that's like famine in the land. People are basically struggling to eat. And in this case, Elimelech took his family and simply got out. And throughout the scripture, there's a whole lot of cases of relocation. Jacob, at some point, had to relocate as well, of course, due to fear of being killed by his own brother. After, of course, he stole his birthright and stole his blessings as well. And he had to relocate to save his life. David had to relocate as well at some point, due to the fear of Saul killing him. Daniel, of course, and Joseph were cases of relocation that happened as a result of being sold to slavery or, you know, being taken from their own country. And that also, of course, was some forms of relocation right there. Jesus, of course, had to be relocated for a season as well when male kids below the age of one was being killed in the land as well. And so just like a lot of people are claiming asylum all over the place, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus had to claim asylum to ensure that Jesus could live for a season. They were in Egypt, and then they returned back to where God had called them to. And these are like, you know, some of the cases of relocation in the Bible. A number of them, of course, existed. Paul, at some point as well, relocated for a season to go, you know, focus and listen to God and study and grow before he came back to focus on the ministry that he had been called to. And we have all of these intrinsic cases of relocation all over the scripture. And you know, these are like many cases. And today, of course, while many people today in Nigeria can't wait to get out, you also have people like the Nehemiahs, of course, who have gotten out, who can't wait to come back as well, to rebuild the nation and to, you know, and fix things. You know, so saying that, you know, maybe it's time to swap, you know, for people to come back so that others can take their place. But that's the reality today. All over the scriptures, a whole lot of relocation moves happened. And today, we want to just look into all of this and ask, what can we glean through the lens of Christ? What can we see through the lens of Christ? What would God have you and I do? What would God have you and I do? What would God have you and I do? And of course, in the same way that we have a lot of people who have left the country who seem to be doing well, we also know that it's not always green on the other side. So it's not an automatic ticket. Staying in Nigeria does not mean failure. And moving as well does not mean success. And of course, that's the reality in our faces. For many people, of course, who are in the US today, like the grandmas and the Ms. Ayobole, for example, probably know a lot of people as well who are over there who are struggling almost as hard as people here in Nigeria. And of course, there are people in Nigeria as well who are living the life, you know, even in the midst of the so-called issues that we face as a nation. And I was reading about a story of someone was saying, this was an article somewhere, and the person was analyzing how an experienced optometrist here in Nigeria, who obtained the Western permit to Canada, moved to Calgary sometime in 2018. But says that, of course, for her to practice, she has to take a lot of exams, pay for all these expensive certifications that will take about 4 years before she's able to practice. And now, basically, what she's doing is that she's working at a grocery store in the interim, right? So these are people who went legally, who have good experience of whatever they're doing in Nigeria, but now in Canada, of course, it's not an automatic ticket. You have to still go through a phase of, you know, writing exams, passing those exams before you can, you know, get those jobs that you feel, you know, you went out for. And today she's working at a grocery store, you know, while getting things together. And so for many people, it's not an automatic ticket. So, once I leave, all problems solved, life is good. Many people also leave, they struggle, and then they find their way back. So we have a mix of all these interesting stories. And so the question for us today is, what would God have you and I do? How do we approach this topic? What should be our stand as believers? And of course, there is what common sense teaches. And the Bible as well, in Ephesians, talked about using your head. And when we use our head, you know, common sense has what it tells us. Common sense has what it shows us. And what common sense does is it analyzes, it looks at data. Common sense looks at the sights, right? Common sense looks at what is in front of us. We do our SWOT analysis. We do our personal analysis. We look at the political situation. We look at the legal situation. We look at the social economic situation. We consider all of these factors, and then we make a decision. Those are the things that common sense leads us to. And if we attempt any form of common sense, right? So look at Nigeria, common sense says to anybody to carry their bags and go. That is what common sense shows for the average person, right? Whether you have a for many people today, for example, who are they've left school, they're struggling to get a job. Common sense says, you know what, there are opportunities outside. I can get a scholarship, I can leave the country, get access to better education, and then from there stay on in whatever country. And of course, I have, for example, a newsletter today that sends me scholarship opportunities available anywhere in the world. And every single day, there are loads and loads of scholarships that land in my email box saying you can apply for this, you can apply for that. And they're all over the place, from China to Japan to Russia to Canada to US, anywhere you can think about, there are scholarship opportunities available for you to just take that first step, get out of the country, get some education, and then people just stay on from then on. But common sense, of course, shows us that if you look at the trajectory pattern, like Mr. Gospel will say, of the country, it looks to be going south, right? In the first quarter of the year, inflation was at 18%. Insecurities looking like it's at an all-time high. All sorts are happening. The Naira is, of course, being devalued day in, day out. People are literally on a quest for just to survive. If you want rent, of course, it's off the roof. A lot of things are off the chain in the country today, and people are literally struggling. And while things are increasing in cost, people's income are not necessarily matching up with it. So things are getting more expensive. Income is just right there, almost stationary. And in some cases, of course, last year due to COVID, a lot of companies slashed salaries. Until today, those salaries are not back to where they used to be. But of course, expenses are still growing. And I was sharing in church today how I went to Chicken Republic. And for me, that was like, what? You know, and there's this standard meal, you know, this Chicken Republic sells. That is, you have jollof rice, you have moi moi, and you have a drink. And all of that sells for, I think, 800 naira when it first started. And of course, that was something a number of people could easily afford. They had one as well that was just rice and chicken, and it was 500 naira. And, you know, it tipped them significantly, because now you have, people, whether you are middle class or lower class, people could afford to get this meal, and you know, that was good. They were good for the day. And I went in there yesterday, and this meal that used to be 800 naira is now going for 1,100 naira. I was wondering, you know, if big companies who have volumes, who can do all sorts of things on the back end in terms of the demand they are making, they can cut costs significantly due to the volume buying they do, still need to increase their prices significantly like that, then of course those are not good signs to see. If you go to the market, what used to sell for 100 naira now goes for 200, that's for 300, that's for 400. Apple, for example, I said Apple is now 250. I was sharing how a professor of medicine was saying to us the other day that people, you know, to live healthy, you need to take 7 servings of fruit a day. I'm wondering how can people afford to do 7 servings of fruit a day in the country that we live in today? But of course, with all of this, what it shows us is common sense tells anybody that what you need to do is have a plan B. Like we've said, common sense says carry your bag and just go. And many people, of course, are eating to common sense and taking action. But for us as believers right here in this room, how do we approach this from the lens of Christ? How do we approach this from the lens of Christ? And this morning, someone was saying to me in church that, you know, one person was saying, I just feel like this is a test, especially for people who can afford it. That I feel it's a test, because if you can afford it, it's really where the rubber meets the road to say, will you stay if God is saying, telling you to stay, or will you move? A person says, you know, I just feel that this is a test. And, you know, when we got home, my wife was asking me that, you know, there's this person, you know, who is one of our family friends who had the ministry in Nigeria and shut down the ministry and left. to Canada. And people were asking him, what happens to your ministry? And he says, God is everywhere. God is everywhere. So ministry continues in Canada. She was wondering, what is going on? Yeah. And so for us as believers, right, how do we look at this? What through which lens do we look at this? And of course, the only lens we have is the lens of Christ. And it's important to note, right? It's important to note that the lens of Christ is an eternal lens. Many of us, of course, look at these things very short term, but God sees a deeper picture that goes beyond how far that we can see. And if you take, for example, Genesis 12, the Bible talks about Abraham. And Abraham, of course, when there was famine, after God had told him, I will take you to a land, I will show you, there was famine and Abraham went to Egypt. And of course, finding himself in Egypt, he had to, of course, talk about the fact that his wife was his sister to ensure that, he was not killed. And then from there, after that was revealed, the Bible said that they were sent out of Egypt by Pharaoh and they gave them, all forms of gift, including female servants, right? Including female servants. And of course, after a while, when Sarah was not giving birth, the Bible records that Sarah gave to Abraham one of her Egyptian servants, or one of our female servants from Egypt, which of course they got when they relocated temporarily to Egypt. And that journey, of course, led to Abraham and Hagar, and then we have Ishmael, and we all know the journey and the story of Ishmael till today. And that's, of course, created a whole new line that in many ways the world is still battling with. So our simple decisions to take action or not take action have eternal consequences, and God alone is the one who can guide and who can lead us in the right way to go. And so as believers, understand that wherever we are, God is with us, and there is He's the one that needs to lead us onto taking action. The lens of Christ is an eternal lens, and it's important that we don't just choose to move based on what we see by our sight. The lens of Christ is an eternal lens. The lens of Christ is a faith lens, not a sight lens. The lens of Christ is a faith lens, not a sight lens. And like I said, common sense is moved by sight, but the lens of Christ is moved by faith. Common sense is moved by sight. The lens of Christ is moved by faith, right? And so today, even though things might look gloomy, things might look like it's a mess, the lens of Christ peels out all of those things and is able to show us something deeper. Like I said earlier on, living does not guarantee success, staying does not guarantee failure. And if I go back to the book of Ruth, very quickly, the book of Ruth that we read, when Elimelech took his family to relocate. And let's see what happened to this family. The Bible records, it says in verse 3, then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died. And she was left a widow for her two sons. They took wives for the Moabite women. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. They lived there about 10 years. Then both Mahlon and Chilion also died. So the woman Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband. So on this journey of relocation, she literally lost everything. Verse 6 now says, then she set out with her daughters-in-law to return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in Moab how the Lord had taken care of his people in giving them food. She had heard how the Lord had taken care of his people in giving them food. And so what made them rush out to leave was because there was famine and there was no food. But now, out after losing it all, she heard that the Lord did not leave his people. The Lord took care of his people by giving them food. And in many ways, the things we feel, I want to go get outside of there, God has your own there. And that's why we said that where is your there? Because God has designed for you from the beginning of time. God has a plan for you. God has a plan for me. And it says, the plan I have for you is of good and not of evil. God has a plan for you. God has a place for you. And in his plan for you, he has a place in mind for you. And if we read quickly, in the book of 1 Kings 17, and that's where we got the topic of today from, where is your dear? In the book of 1 Kings 17, the Bible says, and Elijah, the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead, said to Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel lives before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, for I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. So God had prepared a place. God has prepared a location for Elijah in the midst of the famine, in the midst of the mess that was going on in the country, to be fed and to be taken care of. And for you and I as well, understand that God has a location. Your location matters. God has a plan. God has a place he has called you to. God has a place where you are meant to fulfill the destiny and the plans that he has for you. And back to the question my wife asked me, saying, you know, this person said, God is everywhere. And she was asking, he said, you know, you were saying in church today that location matters. But this guy was saying to us that God is everywhere, so I can continue my ministry in Canada. But while that is true, because God is everywhere, reality is God, while you can be in Canada and still do your ministry, understand that if your calling had been to for your ministry to happen in Nigeria, then you can be in Canada and still struggle. You can be in Canada and not get the results that God had planned for your life. And you know, I was saying, if Dangote, for example, had relocated to the US, I doubt that today he will be the richest African. He will be the richest black person. The richest Nigerian, or the richest Nigerian today. If I would get to US, maybe he would have been living a good life, a comfortable life, but probably he would not have been able to build the kind of wealth he was able to build, leveraging on the opportunities available here in this country. And that is the question that we need to look at, because God has a plan for you. God has a plan for you. God has a location for you. And while I can carry my bag today and leave and go to the US and live a comfortable life, I can get a good job, you know, and live a good life. I have my house and pay my mortgage, right? And all of those things. Life is good. But is that all that God has called you to? Is that all that the potential, the possibilities that God has deposited on us is going to reveal? For many of us, where God will have us function is in Nigeria. For some of us, it may be Canada. For some of us, it may be US. But we need to know where our day is. We need to know where our day is. Where is God calling us to? Where is God calling us to? And so, looking at this from the lens of Christ, we must understand, and even if in that same 1 Kings 17, when the brook dried up for Elijah, the Bible says God came back again. God said, and it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had not been rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. And so it doesn't matter what the mess is, if you're there, is here, God will provide the necessary things to keep you going, to take care of you, and to, you know, and to meet your every need. And for many of us, of course, who are taking relocation today, if we are to look at this from the lens of Christ, understand that God has to speak to you. And the lens of Christ, ladies and gentlemen, is a relationship lens. It's a lens that is personal. The Bible says that God said to Abraham, 1 Kings 17, God said to Elijah, what is God saying to you? What is God saying to you? Exactly. results we can get anywhere. And you know, you can live a good life, you can live a comfortable life, you can even earn in hundreds of thousands of dollars. But is that what God has called you to? Is that the fullness of the calling that God will have us be? And so God said to Elijah, God said to Abraham, what is God saying to you? And God might be saying to you, maybe it's relocate to Ojodo, maybe it's move to Abuja, maybe it's to Ghana. But when we just look at what the world is doing, when we look at what common sense teaches, when we look at what everybody is doing, we just go on the folic of our own. We just take our own steps, moved by the crowd. But as believers, we are not moved by sight, we are moved by faith. We are not moved by sight, we are moved by faith. And so we are called to obedience. Obedience to what God is telling us to do. Obedience to what God is telling us to do. Obedience to what God is telling us to do. Paul wanted to go preach somewhere, and the Bible says that, you know, the angel revealed to him over the night and says, no, that's not, you're not meant to go there. You're not meant to go there now. And so common sense felt, pack your bags, go, next destination. But God says, no, not for you, not now, right? And so there's a consideration of where is my day, and the consideration of when am I meant to go. And these are times, these are seasons. People go, and as you will see all over the scripture, Jesus relocated for a season and they were back. And in Genesis, let's look at this again, because this is also one of the key things that shows us why it is important to listen out for God's instruction in these issues. While common sense sees us a lot to do, God himself sees beyond what we can see. Genesis 26, verse 1. And the Bible says that now there was a famine in the land of Canaan, besides the previous famine that had occurred in the days of Abraham. So Isaac went to Gerar to Abimelech, king of the Philistines. And the Lord appeared to him and said, do not go down to Egypt. Stay in the land of which I will tell you. Live temporarily as a resident in the land, and I will be with you, and I will bless and favor you, for I will give all these lands to you and to your descendants. And of course, if you go down to about verse 12, then Isaac planted in the land. Isaac obeyed God and stayed where God would have him stay. And in verse 12, the Bible says, Isaac planted seed in that land as a farmer and reaped in the same year 100 times as much as he has planted. And the Lord blessed and favored him. If Isaac had gone to Egypt, he would probably have had food to eat, but will he have enjoyed a 100-fold increase on what he did? Probably not, because he would not have been walking in the fullness of where God had commanded him to be. But when he stayed where God will have him stay, the Bible says he sowed in that land and reaped 100-fold. And of course, he sowed in that land and had exceptional productivity. And of course, that's our anchor scripture for the year. It's our year of exceptional productivity. And understand that our being exceptionally productive will be connected to our obedience to where God will have us be. And that can mean, for some of us, changing jobs from one job to the other, moving from one city to the other, moving from one country to the other. We need to obey and be willing to move as God will have us do. And if I can afford to take my leave today and God says stay, will I obey? If I can't afford to even relocate and God says it is time to go, will I act? Right? Will I act knowing that the person who has said go there has made provision ahead to make it happen, and so even for those of us who says no, you know, I'm in Nigeria, I'm here, I'm not considering relocation, if God says it's time to move, will you obey? Because as a believer, it's not about you, it's about what God is calling you to, it's about where he's leading you to. And so I can feel, you know what, my own is Nigeria, I'm here, we die here. And God says, no, you are not dying here, you are moving. and we live for you now, be that the voice of the enemy, or will you obey what God is saying to you? And that is the call for us, ladies and gentlemen, today. And the second key thing I would like us to get out of this, is understanding that every moment counts and matters. And we must make the most of our time, the most of the season, the most of the moments. The Bible says that the eyes of the fool is at the ends of the earth. And many people in the quest to relocate have suspended today, have suspended the moment, all in the quest to get everything they can to move to where they feel is the dream location, where God is leading them to, or where they feel is where they are, you know, where they will hammer, you know, and live and live well. But every moment in God counts, because the Christ lens, like we said, is an eternal lens. The lens of Christ is a lens of service. The lens of Christ is a lens of love. And in the moment, every single day, every single hour, God has a calling for us. God has a calling for us. The lens of faith is not moved by sight. It is moved by faith. The lens of faith, no matter where we are, needs to maximize the time and shine the light of God. Every moment we have, every second we have, will be accounted for. And we won't get to the throne room. We will not get to judgment and say, "Oh Jesus, you know, the reason why I could not function was because I was trying to, you know, save money to relocate to Canada, and so, you know, I could not help my neighbor because I was saving money. I could not do the things that you have called me to do. I could not be generous because I was trying to plan to exit. And once I get there, then those things I wanted to do, now I can start the NGO. Now I can begin those things." No. Those will not be tenable excuses. Everywhere we find ourselves, anywhere we find ourselves, part time remains the location for God to shine his light through us. And while God will lead some of us out, while in the wait, while planning, while seeking his face, while hearing him, understand that every moment must be maximized to fulfill that which he has called us to. Every moment must be maximized to fulfill that which has called us to. When we are led, we obey. We continue to shine his light. We continue to shine his light. And ladies and gentlemen, today, understand Psalm 33, verse 23. It says, "The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him." The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him. And in Proverbs 3:5, we are ready doing this devotional that we are going to at the moment. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding." Well, ladies and gentlemen, your own understanding is common sense. Your own understanding is analyzing and looking at the data and taking action. But it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart." Let him lead. Let him lead. Let him be in the driver's seat. And for you, it could mean staying. For you, it could mean leaving. But let him be the one in the driver's seat. We won't move because we are told to move by a man. We move because we are told to move by God, who has times and seasons in his hands, who sees 20 years, 30 years, 40 years ahead, who knows what he has created you to do and where he has placed you to be. And for those of us who make the move, we need to know for when. And that was the struggle the Israelites had, you know, when they had to relocate some of them due to war, you know, to another country. And it was a battle of, are we here for 2 years or are we here for 70 years? Those are questions. Those are timing. God knows why he's leading you there, and he knows for the timing he's calling you to be. Are you meant to be there for 2 years and now you have been there for 50 years? Are you meant to be there for 70 years and you have packed your bag at 5 years? We need to hear him, and we need to know where he's leading us to per time. And so today, if you are not living with anything, understand that there is a place, there is a day for you. And is that day that God has commanded the raven to feed you? Is that day that God has commanded the widow to feed you? And for you, the question that we need to take to God in prayer is, Lord, where is my day? Where is the location that you have prepared for me? And help me to act. Help me to obey. And it's not that I can't afford it. If God is leading your heart somewhere, it's not I can't afford it. He that is leading you there will make it happen. And so it's not a problem of I can't afford it. It's simply where is God leading you to? Where is your there? And the second that I will want you to live with today in this meeting is maximize the moment. It doesn't matter where you are, we carry God on our inside. And while we are here, whether it's America, whether it's UK, whether it's Nigeria, while you are in this place at this time where you are today, God has given us a commission to go into the world, to shine his light, to preach the gospel, to be generous, to love, to give our time, to give our resource, to give of ourselves, that we might bring people into maturity. And so we don't wait until a perfect time when we move to a particular location to do the things we are commanded to do. Every moment counts, and we must maximize that moment. Don't pause your life in a quest of, oh, I'm getting ready to move, I'm getting ready to relocate. Every moment will be accounted for. You don't know what tomorrow holds. I can be planning for Canada to happen in 5 years, and I'm gone to be with the Lord in 3. How do I give account? Every moment counts, and I must maximize that moment for the master. And when it leads me to go to Canada, when it leads me to come back from the US to Nigeria, wherever it's leading me to, I know that that is my day. And in those moments, at those times, I must continue to shine his light. Amen. This evening, I want us to just take words to go wherever you are. I just pray that indeed God will lead you, that in this relationship that we have with Christ, God will speak to you. God will lead you. He will show you your own there. In the land where there are plenty of opportunities, there are people who still don't have a job. In the land where it looks like it's flowing with milk and honey, there are people who are still begging for bread. Where is your there? And in the land where it looks like people are struggling, God is blessing and creating abundance for his own people. Where is your there? Pray to God this evening that indeed God will lead your heart aright, that you will not struggle with him. You will not go on a frolic of your own. You will not go with just common sense. You will trust him and walk with him. And in the moment, in the now, wherever you are, God will grant you the grace to maximize the moment and to continue to shine his light. And I pray that in the name of Jesus, this will be our reality. Every single day of our lives will count. And whatever is leading us to, we will act, we will move, and we will continue to do his will in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Pastor, the